evening, 393 in your hymnals. Pray About Everything, page 393. Let's all stand, shall we? Ask of your Father.
Before I pray, I want to remind you about the love offering. If you're like me, you thought, oh, I did that. But I did remember in time. So don't be like me. Think about, get ready now before the offering, or if not, before we get away from here tonight. See Mike, see me, see one of the ushers. But let's make this a nice, huge send-off. We're rid of him. He's gone. No, his message, excuse me, his message this morning was a blessing. It was a blessing. And I'm looking forward to a blessing tonight. So let's pray. Lord, thank you for Brother Mike and all he's done for us in the years past, and now how he's helping other churches similar to ours that have a problem with their preacher. Give him power tonight. Meet his needs. Bless his ministry that he might be effective in helping so many other people that need a good pastor. Be with our pastor wherever he is, whatever he's doing. Bless him, give him safety, bring him home safely to us. Bless everything that transpires here this evening, for we ask it in Jesus' name, amen. You can be seated.
Page 371, Even So, Lord Jesus, Come. Page 371.
Thank you.
try and do the announcements again. That was a wreck this morning. I don't know if you know this, but I'm just a little, I don't like to be behind the mic. You might not, I've been doing it for a lot of years. I mean, songs, no problem. But speaking, I don't know. Huh? That's a good idea. Amazing this week. Okay, for the rest of this week, of course, Wednesday evening, 7 o'clock, we'll be here. October the 20th, which is next week, Afterglow for the teens. Don't forget the children's Christmas boxes. And you may read that to your heart's desire. And along with what John said this morning, he's having a prayer meeting at his house at 7 o'clock tomorrow. And basically, the focus is going to be on the election, prayer for the election. Is that correct? Okay. And then also, I just got from Bailey. He mentioned that his mom, Nancy, has a court date the 21st. So if you'd be praying about that, that'd be nice. Okay. John?
Okay, if you had time to write that check. Come on, one poor fellas. He's right, what he said this morning in Sunday school. You and I are blessed to be in a church like this with a pastor that we have. You don't find them very often. That's why I'm driving half an hour to get here, because there's nothing else like this. Amen. There's nothing else like it. So don't take our preacher, his kind of preaching, for granted. Amen. We're fortunate to have him. Amen. He can be a pain, but he loves the Lord, he loves you and I, he loves God's word, and that's good enough for me. Okay, let's pray. We thank you, Lord, for what you've done for us in this church and all you're going to do in the future. We pray that you'll continue to use this ministry here. Lord, you've blessed us financially. May we now continue it. Though we don't need it, but the more we give, the more you'll bless. So bless the gift and the giver once again. And we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Say, my son also plays trombone, but I never sat right in front of him before. If I already wasn't hard of hearing, I'd be deaf right now.
Like it, didn't you?
Thank you, John. Yeah.
How, Sean?
Thank you.
page 394, I Need Thee Every Hour, 394. Let's all stand, shall we? Era's going to play a special, and then Mike's going to come.
Amen. What a beautiful special. And no, I don't think I've met a smilier Christian since we left here than you, sister. What a blessing. Just kind of notice that. Yeah, just the joy. Praise the Lord for that. What a blessing. You know, I was thinking, Brother Sheets, maybe you need to travel with me for a little while. And, you know, you might help me with raising our support. I don't know. Just, you know, I was waiting for him to bust out a tire iron and start heading down the aisle there for a minute. But anyway, but it brings to mind yet a third thing that Pastor really taught me here. And that was, you can't pay me too little or you can't pay me too much because I'm doing what God told me to do. And, you know, that's a philosophy that a shepherd ought to have. I didn't come here for the money. I came here because the Lord called me here. That was his philosophy. And that's what he maintains to this day. And that ought to be our focus, right? But Heather and I are very grateful for your hospitality again. It's been such a wonderful day. The days go by so quickly, you know. And I don't know. It's just been great to reconnect briefly, albeit, with so many of you that mean so much to us. And I've just been treated so well. So thank you. If you would tonight, turn your Bibles to the book of 3 John. The book of 3 John. And we're going to look at this little letter here for just a few minutes tonight. I just want to encourage you to continue to love and pray for your pastor and his wife and be an encouragement to them. The Lord's really blessed you all here with a good pastor. The Lord's blessed him with a good church. And when you realize that, you want to hang on to that. And so praise the Lord for both of those parts of the factor being present here. But 3 John, I'll read it to you here. It says, "The elder unto the well-beloved Gaius, whom I love in the truth. Beloved, I wish above all things that thou mayest prosper and be in health, even as thy soul prospereth. For I rejoice greatly when the brethren came and testified of the truth that is in thee, even as thou walkest in the truth. I have no greater joy than to hear that my children walk in truth. Beloved, thou doest faithfully whatsoever thou doest to the brethren and to strangers, which have borne witness of thy charity before the church, whom if thou bring forward on their journey after a godly sort, thou shalt do well. Because that for his name's sake they went forth, taking nothing of the Gentiles. We therefore ought to receive such, that we might be fellow helpers to the truth. I wrote unto the church, but Diotrephes, who loveth to have the preeminence among them, receiveth us not. Wherefore, if I come, I will remember his deeds which he doeth, prating against us with malicious words, and not content therewith, neither doth he himself receive the brethren, and forbiddeth them that would, and cast them out of the church. Beloved, follow not that which is evil, but that which is good. He that doeth good is of God, but he that doeth evil hath not seen God. Demetrius hath a good report of all men and of truth itself. Yea, and we also bear record, and ye know that our record is true. I had many things to write, but I will not with ink and pen write unto thee. But I trust I shall see thee, and we shall speak face to face. Peace be to thee. Our friends salute thee, and greet the friends by name." Let's pray. Father, we are grateful again to be in your house tonight. And Lord, I'm thankful for the fellowship of the Spirit that is here and for the friendship. And Lord, just the witness, Lord, that we are indeed your children and that we're brothers and sisters in Christ. It's such a precious thing, something that a commodity we can't put a number on. But we're grateful for it tonight. We're grateful to be your children. And Lord, I asked as we look at this, a few verses here tonight, God, that you might minister to our hearts and challenge us, strengthen us, and encourage us in a way, Lord, that you would see fit. And Lord, help me to say what I should say tonight. And I'll just thank you for it in Jesus' name. Amen. The theme of this epistle, I think, you know, is truth. You see the word truth show up six times here, and then the word true, a different form of the same word, another time. And John, the Apostle John, he calls himself an elder, and he literally was elderly, not just an elder of the church, but he was elderly. He was way up in years at the time of the writing of this epistle, from what I can understand. And he had lived a very full life and served God amazingly. He had spent time with Jesus in person. And so when he's talking about truth at this point in his life, he has a really firm grip on truth. If you remember John chapter 1 and verse 14, it says, "And the Word became flesh and dwelt among us," right? And he was talking about Jesus. And he said, "We beheld his glory, the glory as of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth." And so John, of all the apostles, was probably best qualified, even though these were the words of God, we know that. But he was probably best qualified as any of them to write on this topic of truth. And, you know, isn't truth important? I mean, doesn't truth matter? I don't know that it ever has been more obvious in our society how important truth is. And in some cases, how hard people will work to hide truth, to obscure truth. And Satan's behind that. He's the father of lies, and he loves to obscure truth. And he doesn't just stop in the political realm and in the world. He wants, of course, to infiltrate the church and take away the truth from the church. And the church is supposed to be the pillar and ground of what? The truth. And our source of truth is God's Word. And so we need to really make an effort to hang on to it. And I probably think a lot about this and mention it comes up. I know some of my messages, I was thinking today, I wonder how many of my messages sound like the same message from a different text. and I don't want to be that kind of preacher. But when you deal in certain things a lot, certain things really you become more passionate about things. And I'm understanding more and more as time goes by how important God's Word is. Not that I never thought it wasn't, but the longer that I live, man, if we lose this, we've lost everything. And we're supposed to hold fast, hang on to truth. And John really understood that. And so he writes here, and again, I believe this is the overarching theme, although he deals with a number of different things here in this little letter. By the way, it would have been interesting to be Diotrephes and be sitting in church today that this letter was read, wouldn't it? John handled this situation with this man who was really not a child of God, but had risen up in the church. John handled this biblically. He tried to deal with him, and he wouldn't receive it. And so he wasn't there in person. He sent a letter to the church. He realized that the integrity of the church was at stake if the truth did not prevail. And so he put a case out there before the church to be read to the church, and that so that the truth would stand. So I want to look here at the truth about walking in truth and what some of the effects of truth. We look here in verse 1, and my first observation or point is that the truth brings brotherly love. He says, "The elder unto the well-beloved Gaius, whom I love in the truth." Gaius is the man, maybe possibly the pastor, at least the man of influence within the church that John was directing this letter to. And he says, I love you in the truth. And there is no real love outside of truth. There is no, I mean, godly love outside of truth. Otherwise, we have pretense. We have pretend. We have play. It's plastic. It's just not real. But brotherly love can exist between people who have dynamically different personalities, different interests in life, different upbringings, different educations, different interests, all these things. But there has to be that common denominator of truth. And God's Word is what we all rally around tonight. I'm sure if we talked for a little bit here tonight, we could find a Colts fan. Shame on you. Just kidding. As a Bears fan, shame on you. No, we can, you know, get into silly arguments over cars or whatever, you know, sports, silly stuff. But there's obviously harder issues that people separate over. But the thing that'll bring them back together is truth. It's a thing that must be in our lives if we're going to have true brotherly love and unity within our church. You have different parents. I have different parents. But yet our blood, because of the blood of Christ being through us and in us being born in the family of God, we have that same spiritual bloodline. And we rally together against all odds, against all differences, against all challenges in love because we walk in truth. So we see the truth brings brotherly love. But then we see also in verse 2, he says, "Beloved, I wish above all things that thou mayest prosper and be in health, even as thy soul prospereth." Soul prosperity comes from walking in truth. Spiritual prosperity comes from walking in truth. And I wish I was smart enough to say that I was the one that thought of this came up with this thought, but I didn't. But I was reading on this passage, and a commentator, I don't remember which one, but he says, wouldn't it be an interesting thing if everybody's physical health was a direct reflection of their spiritual health? Because that's what he's saying here. I wish above all things that thou mayest prosper physically and be in health physically, even as thy soul prospereth. This Gaius was doing well spiritually. I don't know how he was doing physically. I don't know how he was doing financially, but he was doing really good spiritually. And if you're doing well spiritually, that's the most important thing. There's probably folks tonight who are sick who would be incredibly healthy if their body health reflected their spiritual health. Conversely, we might want to have 911 on speed dial just in case somebody's spiritual health is not doing as good as they are physically tonight, right? I mean, think about that. But the type of health that matters is the type that you can control. I mean, granted, diet, exercise, good genetics, whatever, good luck, all that may play a role into your physical health. You have some say over that, but you have all the say in the world over your spiritual health. All the say in the world. Isn't that something? You don't have to get up and go to a gym to get spiritually in shape. I mean, you can be sitting in your recliner. You can spend time in the Word, spend time in prayer, and find yourself doing better. You can increase your health by sitting down. Sounds like an infomercial for some cheesy thing, you know. I saw one a while back where somebody was sitting on their couch and they're just moving their feet on these little pedals like this, and they're talking about all these calories are burning. I thought, wow, I mean, I don't know, maybe. But anyway, we get focused so much on the external measurements and all that sometimes, and we lose track of the type of prosperity that really matters. And and health is good. We all want to live a long time. We all want to spend a lot of time with our families and all that, and have health to do that with. But, you know, if we're doing good spiritually, John points out to Gaius, he says, that's what really matters. So the truth brings the best kind of prosperity. Then we see a third thing here, and we're going to look in verses 3 and 4. He says, I rejoice greatly when the brethren came and testified of the truth that is in thee, even as thou walkest in the truth. And then he says, I have no greater joy than to hear that my children walk in truth. And I want to see here that the truth will produce evidence of itself in you. If the truth is in you, it'll produce evidence of its existence there. There's people that really believe lies. You know that? I mean, there's people that really believe in evolution. I mean, they believe it. They are sold out to that. It's not true, but they believe it like it is. And but how much more then should we believe and have God's word in us and allow it to shape and to change our lives? In verse 4, he says, I have no greater joy than to hear that my children walk in truth. And so evidently there was a spiritual sonship possibly there between John the Beloved and this gentleman named Gaius in the church there. There must have been maybe he had led him to Christ, maybe he had discipled him. I don't know what all the connection is there. But he told him and encouraged him with the joy that it brought to him to know that somebody that he had a part of bringing to Christ, somebody he had influenced for Christ, was walking in the truth. And parents, isn't that true for us too, you know, in the children in the flesh? I mean, when we... You know how your kids are doing, you know. Sometimes they tell you they're doing this way, and you kind of know they're maybe not doing as good as they say that they are. But then there's sometimes when you say, you know, you get a phone call, you get a text, and it's one of your kids, and they're you know, they heard a message, and it really spoke to them, or they were studying their Bible, and the Lord really showed them something. Boy, that does something for your heart. To me, that's one of the greatest blessings. The biggest smile that can come to Heather and I's face is when we hear our children get a phone call or something from them, and just they talk just about what God is doing in their life. And that's what John is saying here. No greater joy. There's no greater source of joy available to us than we live in the truth. If you're a happy person in your heart, if you're a joyful person, you're walking in truth. You're anchored in truth. The world might not be doing so great around you. You might have challenges in your life, but because of the truth that indwells you, and by the way, that is a fruit of the Spirit, isn't it? Love, joy, and peace. And that'll bring happiness and joy to our lives when the Holy Spirit is allowed to do that. But it's not just about knowing the truth. There is a difference probably tonight. There's folks who have, you know, great Bible educations, much greater than mine. Maybe I know there's those who have been walking with the Lord way longer than I have. And you have access to, in your mind, to much greater truth. You've filed it away and than I do even. And I know a fair amount of the Word, I feel like. But there's not going to be a test when we get into heaven where God's going to say, okay, put your books away. No Bible. No cheating. I'm going to give you a test on what you know about my Word. That's not going to be the test. The test will already have been taken in this life. And it's not so much what you know, but what did you do with what you knew and what you understood to be true. And that, and John could give a good report on him because he was walking in truth, because he was living the truth. In James chapter 1, verse 22 through 25, I'll read it for you. It says, but be doers of the word and not what? Not hearers only. And so we can have truth come into our ears. We can sit in church. We can absorb a lot of messages. We can go to Sunday school. We can have Bible studies. We can do all this stuff, and we can have it all around us. But the fact of the matter is, we have to let this truth go from our head down into our heart. And he says, for if any be a hearer of the word and not a doer, he is like unto a man beholding his natural face in a glass. For he beholdeth himself and goeth his way, and straightway forgetteth what manner of man he was. I have been guilty of that before. I've been guilty of that before. You ever got under conviction for something in a message or in a service or something, and you even respond to the invitation? Lord, I'm gonna do something about this. This about my life is gonna change. I'm gonna put this good habit in place. And then sometime later, you kind of forget about it. What did you do? You looked into the mirror of God's word. You saw the reflection of yourself, and you're like, ooh, that can't be pleasing to God. I need to comb my hair, spiritually speaking. I need to do something here. And you talk about it. You think about it. You maybe pray about it. But in actuality, it doesn't come out. And that's what he's saying here in James chapter 1. He goes his way. He forgets what manner of man he was. But whoso looketh into the perfect law of liberty and continueth therein. And God's word, the gospel of Jesus Christ, is the perfect law of liberty. It brings liberty. And but the person who hears it, receives it, and continues in it, this man's going to be blessed in his deed. And so we understand exactly what John was saying here when he talked about that this man had a testimony of truth and was a joy bringer to John because of the fact that he lived in truth and he walked in truth. Now, I want to share something with you, and I feel like this is applicable here, and I believe that this church, by and large, embodies this. But he says something else to Gaius. He says, beloved, verse 5, thou doest faithfully whatsoever thou doest to the brethren and to strangers. In other words, you're faithful in what you do here. Which have borne witness of thy charity before the church, whom if thou bring forward on their journey after a godly sort, thou shalt do well. Because that for his name's sake they went forth thinking nothing of the Gentiles, we therefore ought to receive such that we might be fellow helpers to the truth. And so we see here that the truth has its helpers. You see, God's word is truth. But God's interested, and he didn't just take us home to heaven when we got saved, because he put his truth in us. He says, now I want you to take that truth. I don't want you to go out there. I want you to be missionaries or send missionaries. I want you to reach the people in your community. I want you to bring them to the truth. I want you to train them up in the truth like you have been. And that was what Paul was saying there. He says, listen, some folks have come my way. We had a conversation about you. Your name came up. Don't you get nervous when you walk up to somebody? Hey, we were just talking about you. And you're trying to decide whether you want to ask what they were saying or just say, oh, that's interesting. That's interesting. Just leave it right there. You don't want them to lie. You don't want to tempt them to say something that they don't really mean. But this is what happened here. There were some folks that went by, and they were talking with John, and they were probably from that same church. And they said, man, you know, Gaius is such a great Christian. And not only does he walk in truth, but he's generous. This man, he practices what he preaches. He says, thou doest faithfully whatsoever thou doest to the brethren and strangers, which have borne witness of thy charity before the church. And so he embellishes a little bit on the people that he's helping and the people he ought to keep helping. But we ought to be engaged in that, shouldn't we? Being a blessing. If you can't go, you can send, right? If you can't go, you can pray. If you can't go, you can pray that the Lord would raise up other people who he wants to go. And that was what I was saying this morning in Sunday school class. We need to really be, as a church, really commit to praying the Lord of the harvest that he would send forth laborers into his field. Because that's what he told us to do anyways, to hold our end of the rope in that way. So we see that the truth has its helpers along the way. And as you walk in truth, don't you wish sometimes, especially with people that are hard-hearted, that you could just kind of reach in and turn the dial on their heart? Don't you know people that you love that don't have Jesus in their life, and you just wish you could reach into their mind and take the blinders off? That's what Paul told the Corinthian church. He said, hey, the God of this world has blinded their eyes, blinded their mind. They can't see. We know people that way that we're praying for. God, please, I pray that way. God, please take the blinders off of their eyes. They think they're okay. They think they're a pretty good person. They think they're a pretty moral person, a pretty honest person, so they're going to go into heaven. And we know that's not true. And so we, as we possess truth, we become passionate about it, that others would embrace it as well. But then also we see on a little bit of a negative turn in the story here, the truth has its detractors. Whenever God's word is flourishing, immediately Satan's going to pop up. I'm in my Bible reading in Acts right now, and it just really fresh in my mind how that everywhere that the Apostle Paul went, or Barnabas, or Peter, all the different saints, soon as a revival would start up, Satan would send his workers along. And you had the seven sons of Sceva. I just was reading about those turkeys the other day, which I didn't end up very good for them. But then you have the other guy who thought that the Holy Spirit could be bought with money. You know, you had that. You had the Jews that would be in foreign countries. They were displaced from Israel. And whenever a great revival would start taking place and folks were getting saved, boom, they would stir up all the idol worshipers and say, hey, these people are preaching against your country and against your religion. And these people are here to totally turn this world upside down on you and totally take away the things that you really love and believe. They're here to destroy your culture. That's what the world's saying about Christians today and missionaries. They say, you don't want these Christian missionaries. They're here to destroy your culture. Culture of what? Right? Culture of what? Of death? Culture of barbarous acts? Death culture. Yes, amen, we are. I'm okay with somebody wants to accuse us of that. We are. But the truth always has its opponents. And that was what happened in his church. His church is doing good. And Satan says, I got one guy that got my finger on. Now this guy, he looks like he fits right in. He's got the language down pat. He's got a great personality. So he'll just fit in. He'll fit into this church just great. And so, verse 9, I wrote unto the church, but Diotrephes, who loveth to have the preeminence among them, receiveth this not. And I've pondered on this. Probably somebody here that knows more of this than I do. What did he write? I don't think he's talking about this, because this was a follow-up to it. So maybe it was a inspired letter that we don't have record of today. But he says, I wrote unto the church. I wrote to you before, but Diotrephes, he's got to be number one. He wants to have the preeminence, and he won't receive us. He rejects him. Who could reject John the Beloved? Who could reject John? I mean, a man up in years, he doesn't seem like a bad guy to me. Now, Peter, you might have trouble with, right? But John? But he said, he receives us not. And wherefore, if I come, I will remember his deeds which he doeth, prating against us with malicious words, and not content therewith, neither doth he himself receive the brethren, and forbiddeth them that would, and casteth them out of the church. My word, this guy, he was a bad guy. It wasn't enough for him to be miserable. He's going to ruin the whole church. He's going to destroy the unity in the church. He's going to prevent church growth from happening, because anybody that wants to come, he's going to forbid them. He wants it to be us four and no more. He wants to have a little club and not have other folks joining. That was Diotrephes. Wanted to be in charge. And man, we see this sometimes. We really do. I don't believe you have it here at all, but I'm just saying, It's something to be aware of, to keep our eyes open for, because whenever the Lord starts doing something, Satan's going to get it. It's going to get his attention, and he's going to rise up, and he's going to try to destroy it. Now, and sometimes diotrephes is kind of a worst-case scenario, okay? He's kind of a worst-case scenario. But you know, the devil can use good people too. He can get us discouraged. We can have a bad hair day. I have them every day. But you can have a bad day and you can take something the wrong way. Or you can get offended about something. And if you're not careful, you can say something. And that discourages somebody else. And maybe it hits them at a bad time. And the devil just kind of snowballs these things. And a lot of times churches can lose their momentum over something that doesn't seem like a big deal at all. But I would have liked to have been there if John, I don't know if he ever got to have that conversation, but I'm guessing after he heard this letter being read, and if John ever had the opportunity, even as an older man, to walk through that door, that Diotrephes was probably like, oh no, uh-oh, I'm in trouble. He came in person, I'm in trouble. But we have to be on alert. We have to be on the lookout, because the truth will absolutely have those who are trying to detract from it. And Satan is behind all of it. Well, what do you do with the Diotrephes? What do you do in that situation? Verse 11 says, "Beloved, follow not that which is evil, but that which is good. He that doeth good is of God, but he that doeth evil hath not seen God." What do you do with that situation? If you encounter somebody spiritually that's that way, and they're out to just, they're just bitter, they're honestly just playing for the wrong team, whether they realize that they are or not, what do? Well, you don't fall in line with them. Separate yourself from it. Don't allow your family to be pulled into it. You've been running this race very long. You've seen the damage of this, haven't you? Somebody gets pulled off to the side, devil separates them out from the rest of the church, starts working on them, and pretty soon they have a friend in the church, and the friend gets pulled over with them, and pretty soon that little group is gone. That little group is gone. Pay attention to it. Pay attention to it. Cling to the truth. No pastor wants blind allegiance. No good pastor wants blind allegiance. Only to God's word. Only to God's word. Brother Sheets, you hit it on the head. Your pastor loves God's word. He does. He's a purist of God's word. I've talked to him a lot. He is. And you can follow him, like Paul said, follow me as I follow Christ. And nobody, don't drink Kool-Aid. Don't drink Kool-Aid, but be a noble Berean, study the word. Stand on the word. And if you do, you'll have discernment. You'll see these situations. And it'd probably be good for all of us to get a little stiffer backbone, right? And when some of this stuff goes down, say, listen, I don't think you're representing this correct. Or if you really want to stop it, just say, hey, I'll go with you. Let's go talk to him about it right now. And almost every time you do that, the air brakes are going to get popped. And it's not going any further. The truck's stopping right there. Because if they got the wrong intent, they don't want to get this settled. They're out to cause division. They don't have an honest question. They're out to destroy. And so I just encourage you, how you handle the Diotrephes, you don't follow it. You follow that which is good. And you understand what family they're a part of. He that doeth good is of God, but he that doeth evil hath not seen God. And he wasn't just saying literally there, but he was talking about eyes of faith. Eyes of faith. They don't have a relationship with the Lord. They've never believed in Christ unto salvation. So we see that. And then lastly here, I want to look down here on a positive note. Look at Demetrius. So we find Gaius, a good guy. Demetrius, a good guy. Diotrephes, a bad guy. Demetrius hath a good report of all men and of the truth itself. Yea, and we also bear record, and you know that our record is true. Not much is said about Demetrius here. Don't know a lot about him, but we know one thing, he stood for truth. I'm thankful that Gaius in that church and Demetrius had each other, and they stood on the truth. And isn't it an interesting thing that God saw fit to, this is God's enduring word. This is his preserved word. In heaven, there is a copy, and Demetrius can go over now and say, hey, looky here, looky here. I made it. I'm in. I made it into God's word. I'm right here. I mean, the Lord rewards those who hang on to truth. Now, my name, you know, we don't find ourselves in the Bible in the sense that Demetrius can, but Demetrius, is God said, hey, I'm going to recognize that. I'm going to honor that. And just like this morning in Revelation chapter 3, we were talking about the Philadelphian church, and he said, hold fast that thou hast, that no man steal thy crown. We can find our way. We can have our reward. We can have our crown. We can have our works in this life that endure through the next when we hang on to the truth. Because God's keeping record, and he absolutely has never lost a single thing that we have done for him. I promise you, it's there. The question is tonight is, what are we doing with the truth? Are we clinging to the truth? Are we taking it for granted? You know, I think because we have such easy access to God's word, and because we have so much freedom to come and hear preaching and to be a part of the serving the Lord, we have a tendency to take it for granted a little bit. We're not as intent, and we're not as attentive to the truth as we should be. I got a feeling that if things, and I pray that God continues to give us the liberties and the freedoms that we now possess, but I got a feeling that if things get hard in America like it has in other countries, that we're going to be squeezing this Bible just a little tighter. There's not going to be as much dust collected on Bibles as there is right now. Because we're going to want to be as close to God as we can be. We're going to squeeze that truth, and we're going to be in it. We're going to devour it. We're going to be applying it, because we're going to understand that this is our closest connection to God that we can lay our hands on in this life. And that's the message for tonight. I hope it's encouraged your heart a little bit to don't take the truth for granted. Find yourself on the right side of truth. If the devil tries to discourage you or use somebody else to discourage you and draw you away, recognize that it's him that's doing it. God is never going to pull you away from his word. God is never going to try to separate you from a biblical assembly. That's only the work of the devil that can do that. Recognize the voice. Know who's talking. Jesus said, my sheep know my voice, or hear my voice, and they follow me, and I give unto them eternal life. No man can pluck them from my hand. Stay close to truth. Stay close to each other. And God will bless you. Let's pray. Father, we come to you tonight again. And Lord, as we consider in our hearts the value of truth, and Lord, the priority and that we should be placing on it, maybe we're a little bit convicted tonight, Lord. And Father, maybe tonight, even while I'm praying, you've spoke to somebody's heart who's taken their Bible for granted, who's taken this church for granted, or the truth that is preached here for granted. Or maybe we've taken for granted, Lord, that we're saved and there's people around us that we know and love who are outside of truth. They're lost. Lord, may we recommit ourselves to living in truth, absorbing truth, and Lord, then sharing it with others as you send opportunities our way. We praise you, Lord, for this good church, for their good preacher and his family. And Lord, I ask that your blessings would continue to fall on them. And Lord, that you'd keep the door open in front of them, the door of service, the door of seeing souls saved and missionaries sent and pastors and teachers trained up, servants trained up here, Lord. Bless them for the years to come, Lord, till you return, I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, that's the message for tonight. We normally have an invitation, don't we? We always have an invitation. What am I thinking? Well, let me just do this and bow your heads just for a minute. Bow your heads just for a minute. Go ahead and play, sister. Lord, speak to your heart tonight. Maybe you've already done business with God. If the Lord spoke to your heart tonight and convicted you about some aspect of truth, whether it's you're starting to drift from it, whether it's you're starting to question it, whether it's you're taking it for granted, maybe tonight as the piano plays, you would take care of that right now in your seats. Other souls, no doubt, are dependent upon how we handle the truth and whether or not we embrace it and whether or not we speak it to them. Pray for boldness tonight. Pray that God would give you opportunities to share Christ this week, and then be armed, be ready, have God's word on you to give to others. Amen. All right, you can look up here. Just want to thank you again for this day. I want to thank you for your friendliness, for your hospitality, for your care for us. And you guys have a great week. And Lord willing, we'll see each other again soonish. Whatever that is, God knows. All right, you're dismissed.